start this wonderful paper, which is this wonderful session, World War One in Religion and Politics. I'm not going to take any time except to say that it's always so wonderful to come back to these conferences, because not only do Beata and her team put together a wonderful programme of research, scholarship, but it's the welcome. I'm sure everyone who's been to these conferences before has the wonderful feeling of coming home again. And this is something that I think is so difficult to create, but Beata does it. So I'd like to start the session by thanking everybody who's involved, all the wonderful team here, and then we'll start the research. So thank you very much to everyone. Thank you. Now we are running a little bit short of, we're not running short of time, but we'll have to keep to time. So each presenter will have 20 minutes. If we have time at the end of everything, we'll have questions. If not, we'll keep the questions for perhaps tomorrow or later today. So it's a great pleasure to introduce Professor Sergey from Bryansk State University in Russia. He's going to talk about E.E. Spektorsky's memoirs as the source of the history of the First World War. Thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you very much for the invitation. First, I'd like to say that it's my fifth time at this conference, but I wasn't here during 5 years.
Yeah.
So yes, I'm very glad to be here again. I'd like to speak about not so global topic as we had in the previous session. My topic will be a bit more distinctive, but in some extent it will continue the speech of the previous the speaker, the representative of the Ukrainian embassy, because my topic is devoted also to the Ukrainian and Russian subjects. Well, Yevgeny in Russian, or Eugen in English, Spektorsky, is an outstanding Russian scientist and social activist of early 20th century. His work covers a wide range of social science disciplines: theory and legal history, cultural studies, sociology, history of literature, and so on and so forth. Public and state activities by Spektorsky proceeded mainly in the higher education system. In the pre-revolutionary period, he went all the way from the high school of a student teacher to full professor, rector of St. Vladimir University in Kiev. Immigrated in 1920, Spektorsky not only continued overseas active scientific work, but became one of the research and training organizers of the Russian diaspora. He was among the founders of the Russian Scientific Institute in Belgrade. For some time led the Russian Faculty of Law in Prague, as you can see. And Spektorsky's scientific and organizational activity didn't stop until his death in the United States in 1951. A special place is occupied by Spektorsky documents found in archives of the Research Center for the Study of Eastern Europe, University of Bremen in Germany. This research center began to take shape in the late Soviet period with the aim of stocking mainly materials of the dissidents movement in the USSR and other socialist countries. Thus, documents of Spektorsky, who died in 1951 and did not belong to the dissidents, are to some extent except for the archive. Acquisition of the documents by archives a few years ago is due to the activities of the research center archivist, a former Soviet philologist, Gabriel Superfin, who managed to see in the withered manuscripts proposed to the archive by resident of Dortmund, Slovenia, Dr. Vladimir Bodich, the valuable material of the history of Russian immigration and maybe on the history of Europe late 19th, early 20th century in general. Now I have to say some words about well, acquisition of this document, because it's absolutely detective story, and it will be very interesting to my mind to hear about it. And then I shall speak, of course, about First World War in the document. According to the testimony of Bonish, the history of the appearance of documents, appearance of memoirs, there, there is, in May 1945, when the hopes that Ljubljana can be occupied by the British were dispelled, and Josip Broz Tito troops were to enter in it from day to day, a 70-year Petrovsky, white Russian emigre, according to some sources, cooperated with the occupation authorities. In a hurry, with his wife, left the city, where he lived for 15 years, left on foot, hidden towards Italy. Naturally, in some situation, he could not bring big luggage and had to leave most of his things in Ljubljana. Well aware of the special value of wage and a lifelong daily wage records and unfinished but very large memoirs, as well as a multi-volume manuscript introduction to sociology, she hid them under, he handed them to his servant maid, to keep. She, this maid, hid them under her old clothes in the wardrobe at home. As time passed, Spektorsky experienced the brunt of state camps for displaced persons in Italy. In 1947, with the help of the Tolstoy Foundation, was moved to the United States of America. Several times he wrote to the maid, but she was really forgotten where they hid, or maybe she was afraid to speak with the immigrant, but the documents were not returned. In 1951, Spektorsky died. As recalled his friend Glimovich, in the United States, he tried to recover his memoirs, but in vain. Thus, in historiography, they were listed, so far, lost, these memoirs. Further events are as follows. In the early 1950s, sorted all things out, the son of maid, Luba Butinar, stumbled upon the manuscripts. Not feeling interest to them, he gave them to his friend, former Spektorsky student on the faculty of law, University of Ljubljana, and an employee of statistical organization, Vladimir Bonash. In early 1960s, Bonash, having married a German woman, left Yugoslavia for Germany, Western Germany. Since those times, documents were in Dortmund. Sometimes, he said, Bonish offered them to various archives. It was a Slovenian archives, so archives of the Soviet Union, including the archives of the Academy of Sciences of the USSR. But anyway, they said it was not interesting that look for them. And only when Bonish applied to Bremen, Gabriel Zuckerfin, you can see him here, sorry for that photo, was able to appreciate the importance of the documents and to convince the institution to purchase them from the owner. Now they are kept in these archives in Bremen, and you can read them. Memoirs stored in five boxes, sheets, more than 900 pages of notebook format, and is filled with handwritten text. Only the left half of each sheet. Right side sometimes contains additions and corrections. Back page is blank. Text chronologically embraces the life of Spektorsky from birth and the origin of his family until the early 1930s. And the text breaks off in mid-sentence. Find out where the first pages and whether the continuation from Bonish, whom I met in 2009, failed. The text contains many details as of the Spektorsky private life, so description of the events of the era witnessed by him. Just his memoirs. This is the last page. And now I shall speak about the First World War in this memoir. You see, at the beginning of the First World War, Spektorsky was in the process of moving from University of Warsaw, where he was professor, to University of Kiev, so Boston Vladimir University. And he saw just some citations. He saw such things, for example, in Warsaw. Spektorsky was a witness of the confusion that characterized the first months of the war. While passing by Fort Wavell, you know, I, to my amazement, saw that it was durably restored. The war plan was changed, and it was decided to defend Warsaw. When I returned to Kiev, I managed to slip safely through Lublin, which was attacked by the Austrians. And then he began to work as the professor in Kiev. 19, just, it's Kiev University. It's an old, of course, photo, but today's university almost the same. 1914-1915 academic year at the University of St. Vladimir passed as usual. So the memoirs of Spektorsky, not filled with so many memories about the war as evidence of academic everyday life. As Spektorsky recalled, thanks to the war, the inner struggle of various professional groups was stopped. And Grand Duke Nikolai Nikolaevich, it was uncle of the son, was elected an honorary member of the university. Relatively quiet life of the university was broken in the summer of 1915. From the front, there were, now citation, from the front there were disturbing rumors. They talked about the possible offensive of the enemy to Kiev. Pontoon bridges began to build across the Dnieper, and the university received the order to evacuate to the left bank of the Dnieper. Spektorsky recalled that it was received when the danger of occupying Kiev has already passed. You can see here it's in front. You see it. This was the first line, this Warsaw. It's in 1914, and this line 1915, and Kiev somewhere here. You see? It is not on the map, even. Well, the order was received when the danger of occupying Kiev has already passed. So the council of the university was called to discuss how to be. One of the professors made a heated speech about the fact that St. Vladimir University can exist only in Kiev, but military authorities did not cancel the evacuation orders, justifying it with the idea that a large concentration of young people in the immediate rear of the armies is undesirable. We had to evacuate to the right bank of the Volga, to Saratov, whose university agreed to give us hospitality. All the property of the university, of Kiev University, not excluding the library and astronomical instruments, was transported to Saratov. In Kiev, there was only a medical faculty. University professors went to Saratov in the car provided to it. On the way, trains with refugees from Poland and other places, possibly purged by the military authorities, produced a depressing impression. An eerie impression was made by marching companies sent into the front. It was felt that the state was cracking. Nothing consolatory was promised by cardboarded postage stamps that replaced metal money. Already in the spring of 1960, the university was allowed to return to Kiev in autumn. So the Kiev University was evacuated only within 1 year. The cumbersome university property, Spektorsky wrote, was again put in the boxes and sent back. It took more than a year of time to accurately install astronomical instruments in all foundations in the Kiev Observatory. A much larger impact on the internal life of the university, of course, had the revolutionary events of 1917. as memoir is noted, the university was knocked out of the rug. A special page on the Spektorsky activities as university professor in 1970 was the reading public lectures on social science topics, which emerged in the conditions of ideological pluralism, was in great demand. True, Spektorsky sadly concluded that our readings did not produce the desired effect, because the listeners believed demagogues more than we did. Finally, Spektorsky was convinced in the utility of our professorial lectures when he visited the southwestern front in the summer of 1970. Just, it's in the front 1970. Here's Steve, Steve, and this is the front line. Commander-in-Chief of the Army, General Pustagodzinka, met Spektorsky in the headquarters of the 11th Army and immediately put the question squarely. Spektorsky wrote, "Did I come to destroy the army or support it?" It was 1917, between two Russian revolutions, February and October. I replied, "General, do not insult the professor of the University of St. Vladimir." He calmed down and became very polite. In the presence of him and other officers, I read two lectures, each in front of a whole regiment lined up under an open sky. I began by saying that the Russian people have a responsible task to rebuild their state on new basis. Then I outlined the main types of state structure before the soldiers. In conclusion, I appealed to the patriotism of listeners. But I immediately realized how fruitless my speech was. Before I finished my second lecture, the deputation of workers from Kharkov arrived. Kharkov is a, well, you know, big Ukrainian city with a lot of industrial plants. Out of her came a burning brunette of a foreign type, climbed onto the stage that I had just left and said, "Comrades, comrades, we did not start this war, but we will finish it. The English, French, and American capitalists began the war, etc., etc. All of the same kind deserve attention that the German capitalists were not mentioned." I returned to Kiev with a heavy feeling and agreed with some colleagues who came to the conviction that we would have to drink a bitter cup to the bottom. Just I have 1 minute. Because of that, I have no time to speak about just 1918. You see, 1918, which just representative of the Ukrainian embassy said just about, you can see the borders of Ukraine after the Brest-Litovsk treaty. It was Urania, but it was not an independent state. It was state under the German rule. So, two men must be mentioned here. Hetman Skoropadsky, it was former head of the Ukrainian state, and General Field Marshal Heinrich von Eichhorn from German troops, which was the real head of the state. So, Spektorsky in 1918 began, was elected as the rector of the Kiev University, and he had to consult both with Hetman and with German authorities, but he the main administrative contacts with Spektorsky were with ministerial officials of Ukrainian governments. With the Germans, and he recalls, he himself had to deal with just a few times. Once he was even arrested and thrown into Lubyanovka prison, soon released for a reason and remained for him mysterious. In general, judging by the memoirs, Spektorsky tried to stay away from the occupation authorities, and when the former rector of the University of St. Petersburg, Erwin Grimm, Spektorsky wrote, "I do not know on whose initiative persuaded me to make a Germano field speech on behalf of the university." Spektorsky decidedly refused and explained to him that the only salvation of the university is academicism without any kind of deviation towards politics. With the end of the First World War and accordingly the German occupation, professors became carried away by political activity. For example, from famous philosopher Zinkowski, occupied a ministerial post and the head of government, returned to the university. He came to my office, brought repentance, recalled Spektorsky, and I directed him to continue his philosophical work. Well, thus it seems that the above examples, and some more examples if I have time, allow to draw a conclusion about the high value of the memoirs of Spektorsky as a source of the history of the university, allowed during the First World War. Thank you very much.